Welcome to Voices TV. I'm your host, Bill Bright Sprecher, and I publish Voices newspaper. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday is January 15th. This year, we will celebrate it, Martin Luther King Day, on January 21st, always the first Monday after his birthday, like every other federal holiday. So let's begin by looking at how Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. became a global leader.
All we say to America is be true to what you said on paper. If I lived in China or even Russia or any totalitarian country, maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I could understand the denial of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they haven't committed themselves to that over there. But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right. And so just as I say we aren't going to let any dogs or water hoses turn us around, we aren't going to let any injunction turn us around. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
I know all of you are studying hard and you're just doing fine in school, and I'm glad to see you.
In the last 2 months of his life, Dr. King faced the idea that civil rights alone could not solve the problem of poverty.
In Mississippi today.
Okay, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
He roamed the South, trying to gain support for Poor People's Campaign. Its goals: full employment, a guaranteed income, and decent housing for every American.
People just don't know, but it's really hard. Not only me, it's so many more in the same shape. I'm not the only one. It's just so many of us right around. It's just no hair, shoes, clothes. It's naked and hungry. For all time, you have to cook your children pinto beans morning, dinner, and supper. They don't know what else to get a good meal.
You all are really to be admired. And I want you to know that you have my moral support. I'm going to be praying for you. I'm going to be coming back to see you. And we are going to be demanding when we go to Washington that something be done, and done immediately, about these conditions.
This was a different Martin Luther King. Just weeks before his murder, in tones suggestive of the Black Panthers, he began to talk about how the government had broken its promise to the newly freed slaves just after the Civil War.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is the reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
Some of us are aware that it's good for us to care. Some of us feel the icy wind, poverty blowing in the air. For those of us who simply like to socialize,
children understand the reason America celebrates a holiday for Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. every year? It's not a day off in most Wisconsin school districts, and in many Wisconsin school districts there is no formal official recognition of the holiday at all. In order for children to understand the impact of Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King on people's lives around the world, they need to hear people share. They need to learn about Dr. King's life, his times, and his work. Here are some great books for children that tell the complex yet compelling story of a great American hero, Dr. King. For our youngest children, nothing gets them ready to read like a great picture book. Prominent picture book author David Adler has written an entire series on famous Americans. His work, A Picture Book of Dr. Martin Luther King, is an outstanding beginning biography that tells the story of Dr. King's lives in a way that children can understand. And it's illustrated with beautiful pictures so they can see the story and that they can actually learn to tell it themselves. Letters from Today's Children to Dr. Martin Luther King is written by Jan Colbert, and it's a compilation of letters written from children to Dr. King. It's fun to imagine how Dr. King would have reacted and enjoyed these letters had he been alive to read them. Many of the letters pull at your heartstrings, and many are just cute and funny. Typically, this is a great book for young readers, perhaps somewhere between the third and the sixth grade. MLK, The Journey of a King, is by Tonya Bolden, is another excellent book about Dr. Martin Luther King, in this case a profile of his life and times. It's also an appropriate read, typically for children between the third and the sixth grade. Mountaintop, How Poverty, Labor Fights, and the Civil Rights Set the Stage for Dr. Martin Luther King's Final Hours is written by Amy Balsam. It's typically a good read for fourth to seventh graders and presents connections between the sanitation strike in Memphis and King's death, which have not received a great deal of attention, especially in books written for children. This book puts the context of a great historical speech and the tragedy that followed into historical perspective and is a good read for the typical fourth to seventh grader. Martin Luther King, A Man with a Dream, is written by Jane Pettit and is another book that would be an excellent read for 4th to 7th graders. It's part of the book series, Book Reports Biographies, which share concise, manageable reads about famous people that have changed our lives. This book summarizes the life of the civil rights leader, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Just Like Martin, by Ossie Davis, is a compelling story for middle and some high school students. Davis has created some historical fiction based on the aftermath of two classmates killed in a bomb explosion in an Alabama church. Mirroring actual events in U.S. history, a 14-year-old organizes a children's march for civil rights in the autumn of 1963. King's Courage is by Stacy Dosh and Rhody Cohen. It's especially a fun read for middle school students, where Mr. Carruthers' History Club travels back in time to help Dr. Martin Luther King decide whether or not he should lead a voters' right march to Montgomery, Alabama in 1965. Martin Luther King, Civil Rights Leader, is written by Robert Jakubik, and it's also appropriate for middle and high school students. It's part of the Black American Achievement series, and it recounts the life of Nobel Prize-winning civil rights leader Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., presenting Dr. King as an intellectual, articulate, and effective leader whose oratorical skills and his commitment to change have propelled him into the national spotlight. In Madison, kids have the day off of school, and across town you'll find a number of observations and commemorations for the late Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. But most school children in Wisconsin do not get the day off, nor do they have access to special commemorative ceremonies. Recreational reading has always been an important part of reading development. Why not share a great book about Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. with a child you love? And if you'd like to know more about the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, visit the website we've created at madisonvoices.com/MLK. That's madisonvoices.com/MLK. It's organized to be a pathfinder. We tell you how to find great books about Dr. King in your local library, online, and we suggest great books, articles, and provide links to other wonderful websites to learn about an American hero. There are many ways we can directly and indirectly influence people's lives. Mentoring is a wonderful way to help people. Let's listen to First Lady Michelle Obama talk about why mentoring is important. And then let's take a look at a very successful mentoring program here in Madison, Mentoring Positives.
We're headed to Denver, and this is the first of what we plan on being a series of mentoring events that we want to do around the country. And mentoring has always been a big part of my success as well as Barack's. People have always lent a handout to us, whether it was our own parents or grandparents or other people in a wide variety of professions. So we really want to promote and emphasize the importance of mentoring young people at all stages. And we thought that what better way to do it than from the platform of the White House.
The First Lady sent over an invitation and asked if I would be interested in coming. And of course, I mean, I spent a lot of time on women's issues, children's issues, young girls, knowing how important it is to have mentors.
We've all had so many hands helping to pull us forward that it's important for us to offer one going back.
I've had mentors my whole career. And I say all the time when I talk to young people, boys and girls, that it's the most important thing you can do for your career. It doesn't have to be a long-term thing, but it has to happen.
We all need to make sure and extend a hand and pull some folks along with us, and I take that pretty seriously.
Barack and Michelle Obama aren't unique. There are millions of young people like us who come from modest backgrounds, modest means, who have been able to use hard work, determination, and a lot of self-confidence to sort of move through life despite, you know, what people think you can or can't do.
All of us sort of feel that when we look at you, we see a part of ourselves in each of you. I know I do.
It's a very exciting synergy of pairing together potential women leaders of tomorrow with the women leaders of today.
And we had a wonderful lunch. I got a chance to mingle. I had 8 girls at my table, and we chit-chatted about what success means and how you make it happen.
The truth is, the ladies who were mentors here that you see today, they didn't come here or get to this stage because of some magic. And that's a point that I make every time that I talk to young people. I want them to look at me not as the First Lady of the United States of America, but I want you to first see me as Michelle Obama, a girl from the South Side of Chicago who went to public schools, whose parents were working class folks. There is no magic to being here.
We started out as girls, and we, step by step, finding that encouragement wherever we could, we were able to build our lives that we have.
I know for myself, I can speak personally, I wouldn't be where I am today, and I couldn't be standing up even in this day if it weren't for the mentors and the people that I trust and that I share my life with.
And then after the luncheon, all the mentors, or most of them, are going to fan out to local public schools. I'm going to go to Denver South High School.
Now is the time to practice being good people, because ultimately, that's really all that matters. You know, if you're a great bus driver and a good person, if you're a great ice cream scooper and a good person, you're adding value to the society, truly. But the practice is now. You can't think that you can be a jerk and lazy and trifling now, and that one day you're gonna wake up and just be great, right? It's practice. And I tell my kids this now. Make up your bed today so that you know how to make up your bed when you're 20, you know? Clean up your room now so that when you go to college, you don't live like a pig, right? Do your homework now, not because you have to, but because you need to be in the practice of sitting down and finishing what you start. That's the kind of advice I would give you guys. It's not rocket science, but it is effort. And if you can do that now, you will be successful. You will be successful.
You know, hopefully this will bring some attention to efforts that people do around the country anyway. We're not the first people to think of mentoring, but this is a way to highlight it and to encourage people, other adults, to think in this time that they can reach out to a younger person and bring them along.
Congratulations to Mentoring Positive. We've had a wonderful partnership with the Madison Police Department and Will Green and Mentoring Positives. A few years ago, I asked our neighborhood officers, and these are the officers that are at Ground Zero, they're in the neighborhoods on a daily basis. I asked the neighborhood officers if there were certain services that they could have more of within the city of Madison, what would they like to see? And to an officer, they all said two services. One, as a fresh start. The second service was Mentoring Positives, which was interesting that Mentoring Positives really has that type of effect on working in the community and working with our officers. Will Green also, if you have not met him before, he has a unique ability to communicate not only with professionals like law enforcement and other service providers, but he has such unbelievable respect and connection with the young people in our community. He's transformational from the standpoint of being able to not only connect with police officers, but also in a positive way, get young people to do things where they are having a positive impact in the community. Everything from his ability to have them playing basketball or doing something positive with the salsa that he's making. He's just an unbelievably positive person connecting in our community. The other thing I will mention about Mentoring Positives is that they're always ready to assist in any way, shape, and form they can. This past summer, we saw some violence taking place in downtown Madison. And who did we turn to? We turned to Will Green and Mentoring Positives. And within short order, he was able to do outreach. As I said before, connect in a way that I think he has a unique talent in doing that. So it has been an excellent partnership, and I think he has been an asset to this community.
Madison's not a lot different than many American cities with a changing demographic and a changing population. We have a significant number of young people who are African-American, who are Hmong, who are Latino. And this is a very different Madison than, say, 40 years ago or 20 years ago. They now constitute about 25 to 30% of the population of young folks in their late teens and 20s, even though as a total population, Latinos, African Americans and Hmong make up, and other Asians make up about 20-21% of the city's population. These young folks encounter some of the same challenges that we see in other parts of the United States. Higher levels of unemployment, lower levels of educational attainment. In too many instances, this combination leads to frustration. It leads to activities which don't contribute either to the individual's success or to the community. What Will's done with Mentoring Positives is rather special. And two things are going on here. One is Will's professional skills and talents. I mean, you just can't wake up one day and say, I want to go do something to help people, which is admirable. But you do have to have the professional skills. You do have to know what you're doing. Second, now gets into Will's personality, his character, the drive, the commitment, the fact that he gets up every morning thinking about what will happen that day to make someone's life better. And when he starts working with the group that he's assembled, what he's able to do is first cut through the negativity, cut through the discouragement, the bitterness, the anger, and he's able to get young men to understand that no matter what's happened in their past or what they may have missed, that they have a future. He's able to get them to focus on a realistic future, not one that's filled with unattainable dreams, but one that makes them really productive members of the community and will give them fulfillment in their own lives. He's done some very traditional things. He's used education, he's used sports as mechanisms to connect. And then he's sort of harnessed what I consider to be the most powerful force in the universe outside of the sun, and that's peer group pressure among young people. Anyone who's ever raised a kid knows that once they get into their teens and their 20s, it is a constant battle trying to give them direction and trying to hope that they make good decisions, while at the same time pulling away at them is their peers, oftentimes in what I would describe as a constructive direction. Will and those who work with him understand that dynamic, and so what he's done is he's used it very positively in regards to getting young people together so that they still have, obviously, that peer group influence, but it's a very positive one where they see a role in the community for themselves. this being the 8th anniversary, I think it's certainly in order to congratulate Will and all those associated with Mentoring Positives. Maybe the best way of expressing that congratulations is to first to say thank you, and then secondly, to write out a big check.
Mentoring Positives means a lot to me. It's a place where we can all get together and just let go of the outside world and just have fun and just be ourselves. Mentoring Positives lets me know a lot about like life and like the problems that I can run into, especially being an African-American male. Will Green is a great role model for me. He's doing a lot for the community, and I look up to him and what he's doing. One day I hope that I can give back to the community the same way he does. Being a positive influence on other people's lives, and I feel that they're a blessing to the community.
Will has been a great mentor toward me. I can easily say I can look up to him as a father. He taught me things that a father can only teach you. One of the many programs that Will has inspired me to contribute in is an Off the Block Salsa program. It taught me how to become more like a better businessman and like how to look at certain things in different perspectives, like as toward business. Like it teaches young males how to market their own food, how to package food, how to sell it to different people around the neighborhood. And it's really good for the community. My weapons of peace, all across the land, I know I can. I'm ready to release my weapons of peace, all across the land, I know I can.
Loving your country shouldn't just mean watching fireworks on the 4th of July. Loving your country must mean accepting your responsibility to do your part to change it. If you do, your life will be richer, our country will be stronger. We need your service right now, at this moment, our moment in history. Now, I'm not going to tell you what your role should be. That's for you to discover. And I am going to ask you to play your part, ask you to stand up, ask you to put your foot firmly into the current of history. I'm asking you to change history's course.